Here.
Mr. Kaczynski?
Here.
Mr. Mascarpola?
Here.
Dr. Reed?
Here.
Mr. Rogers?
Here.
Mrs. Russo?
Here.
Mr. Sauter?
Here.
Mrs. Fasano?
Here.
Mr. Riley?
Here.
I just want to, before we begin this meeting, I just want to cover a few things. The first thing I'd like to acknowledge is the untimely passing of a high school senior a week ago, which is, I'm sorry. I want to discuss touch on the passing of a high school senior last week, Michael Rosenstein, whose mother also teaches at Lincoln School and used to teach my own kids at that high school. And it's extremely sad, and some of our goals is to lose my family. It's been very difficult for me to solve for everyone. So our hearts, thoughts, and prayers are for that family.
We can't hear.
Page 19 is the balance sheet on the GAAP basis of accounting. You'll notice that this represents the four major governmental funds that the district has. Moving across, the first column is the general fund that really accounts for the day-to-day operations of the district. The second column, special revenue funds, that's where you account for all your state, federal, and local grants. The third column is the capital projects fund. That would be where you account for the long-range projects that have been approved by the referendum. And the last column, the debt service fund, is you solely account for the repayment of principal interest of the district's long-term debt. The first column for the general fund, like I said, is really the day-to-day operations. And those are the fund balances that you would really be concerned with. About halfway down that column, on the left, you'll see fund balances, and there are both restricted and unrestricted components of that fund balance. The first number, which is slightly over $310,000, that represents encumbrances that were placed prior to June 30th, but just not paid, so they were rolled over into the subsequent year's budget and paid cash. The second number, slightly over $127,000, represents your capital reserve balance. And that could be used to fund the local share of projects in the district's long-range facilities plan. The next number, $535,625, represents excess surplus. And what that is the state only allows you to keep back the unreserved fund balance 2% of your operating expenses. Anything above that has to go back as tax relief. So because our audit was completed after your current fiscal year has already been adopted, this amount will have to be used for tax relief in the 2011-12 budget. And the last number, $213,705, is on a GAAP basis of accounting, your unrestricted or unreserved fund balance. A couple of years ago, the state, because of their fiscal problems, started to withhold some recognize that as a payable on their books. You're not allowed to recognize that as receivable under GAAP accounting. But you guys really operate under a budgetary basis as a town. So when you add those real estate payments back in, they total roughly $1.1 million. So when you add that back in, your unreserved fund balance is a little bit over $1,314,000. So that's what you have as what they call free balance moving forward to use in subsequent years. Budget will be able to amend the current year budget in certain circumstances. That's sort of an overview at 2:30 of the financial position. You all have an unqualified opinion. It's obviously what you're always striving for. We didn't have any disagreements with management during the course of the audit. We didn't have any difficulties performing our audit. There were instances of fraud or illegal acts that we discovered. And even though we're presenting the audit today on December 20th, it was filed by the statutory deadline for the state, which is December 5th. So that's good for that. And lastly, in terms of recommendations, there were 5 recommendations in which we go to report. We met previously with the district administration as well as the finance committee to discuss those in detail. The 2 things I would stress that are important are we have 5 this year, but we had 8 last year, so we're obviously moving in the right direction. And none of the 5 this year are repeat recommendations. So we are going to be able to see that prior year corrective action communication. If you have any other questions,
Roger. I don't know if you'll be able to answer this question, but if you can, I can give you. The overall condition, financial condition of this district, can you tell us what it is in your opinion?
Well, if you have excess surplus, which means that your reserve fund balance is maxed out of what the state will allow, so that indicates you're in a strong financial position. Past years you did not have that, so last year you didn't have any excess surplus. Nor did you actually use any surplus in your current year budget that you're operating under, your town election budget. So moving forward, although there's obviously going to be restraints with the governor's new 2% cap on taxes, you have over $500,000 that you're going to be able to put into the budget towards tax relief that in this current year budget you didn't have.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Unanimous. Correspondence?
I received a notice of hearing on an application from the Township of Nutley Planning Board, addressed to the Board of Education. Taking notice that the undersigned has filed an application with the planning board of the Township of Nutley seeking to convert an existing building located at 265 Franklin Avenue, known as Block 5900, Lot 11, into a 7-Eleven convenience store, and they're seeking site approval and the grant of variance related to the number of parking space size, landing location, loading space, signage, fencing, driveway locations, and other variances. Public hearing has been set for January 5th, 2011 at 7 p.m. in the Commission Chamber of Township Hall, Nutley, New Jersey. Directly related to that, there is a resolution on this evening's agenda for the board to adopt, signify their objection to the 7-Eleven. If adopted this evening, will be forwarded to the town.
Thank you, Superintendent's report, please.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Riley. Good evening. It's been a bit of time since our last board meeting of November 22nd. all wrapped up very, very nicely, academics as well as activities and athletics. Many people in this room attended the tree lighting ceremony on the 5th. Technology committee met on the 6th. We had a mediation on the 6th also. Budget committee met on the 13th, and we'll be meeting frequently between now and April. Administrators negotiations began on the 14th, and we have been conducting our lockdown drills as required. On December 2nd and 9th, there was an incident decision day at the high school. 177 students were accepted. $6,508 was saved in application fees. $2,331 was saved in college board ACT fees for score reporting. And the total saved was over $9,000, as well as over $1 million in scholarships offered. Looking ahead, Wednesday is the last holiday concert that takes place at St. Mary's Church. Half day the 23rd, the winter holiday break begins on the 24th. We return on January 3rd. Coming back on the 4th, the Finance Committee will meet. The 5th, we have a mediation. The 13th is our next Board of Education meeting. On the 12th, Mr. Riley and I are meeting with the superintendent and presidents of Bloomfield and Belleville regarding shared services. And on the 13th, the Essex County School Boards Association in Livingston will be having a seminar on the 2% cap and its impact on school budgets. Thank you.
I just want to cover a few things before we go into the committee reports. The first thing I want to touch on is what Mr. Zara just spoke of, which is the fact that for 2 months we reached out to the board secretary, presidents, and superintendents of Bloomfield and Belleville to discuss the potential for shared services. And I appreciate the fact that they have gotten back to Mr. Zara, and we do have a meeting scheduled in less than 3 weeks to sit down with those presidents and superintendents to discuss the potential for consolidating whatever we can consolidate or share whatever services could be shared because of the tremendous budget constraints that we face and the $2.4 million budget shortfall that we'll talk about later on tonight. Also, I want to thank Commissioner Petracco and Mayor Cacciola. They reached out to the board to discuss the potential of having a joint presentation for students on drug awareness. The mayor has a committee called the Municipal Alliance. The Commissioner Petracco has a committee called HOPE, which deals with helping parents identify drug issues with children. And we're very concerned with it as well. So there's going to be a meeting tomorrow to discuss moving forward with potentially putting together a program shortly between the three entities at the high school. So I thank them for reaching out to us on that. I'd like to thank Mr. Tucci, who got back to Mr. Zara last week, because we had put in a request to the commissioner in order to save the district money as well, because we have a tremendous amount of concrete, commercial, brick needs that need to, the buildings need to be repointed. There's areas throughout the district that need extensive brickwork. And since the commissioner has two masons under his employ, rather than put projects out on an RFP and pay regular retail type contractor rates, the commissioner has offered a shared services agreement that we'll get into shortly, with sharing his personnel to save the taxpayers some money on repairs to the school. So we thank the commissioner and the chief for that. We're going to hear a presentation shortly about solar power. For the last couple of years, we've been looking at, as a board, looking at solar energy and its impact on cost savings. About 2 months ago, I attended a public service seminar in Secaucus, and I came away with some good information, and we'll hear a presentation tonight on possible possible cost savings, which possibly can segue into technology needs, staff needs, I'm not really sure. But we know that this district needs to update its technology so that all schools are equal across the board, so that every teacher has a smart board in their classroom, so that every student has the latest technology available to them. And right now, we have a tremendous imbalance if you go from school to school. The high school, in my opinion, is woefully inept as far as the technology needs. So Mr. Kupta Dr. Reed and myself have been discussing academic needs, staffing needs, technology needs, and about a month ago I had a meeting with the superintendent, the principals, and the department chairs about a wish list for their technology needs as well as safety needs. Safety needs would be, for example, fences, playground areas, the playgrounds at Washington, at Lincoln, at Radcliffe, at Yanacaw. All of these areas are in disrepair and need to be repaved as soon as possible. Just don't have the money to do it. So I asked them to send us a wish list of their technology and safety needs, which I have, and I thank them for that. So my vision is that possibly we can tie in a second question proposed to the public, which would require solar panels on all of our roofs in the district. Now, the timing is good for that because we just redid all of the roofs in the district. So we have brand new roofs on every single facility. It's the perfect opportunity to put on solar panels. You don't want to put solar panels on a 20-year-old roof that's going to need to be replaced, and they have to take the panel down and put it back. It's cumbersome. So the timing is good for that. And hopefully we'll hear in this presentation shortly by Ryan Hall from Orion Enterprises, who I thank for coming tonight, as well as one of the vice presidents from Public Service, John Chattel, who's working with me on this as well, who's also a Nutley resident, a good friend, and a big help on pushing me forward with this program. So hopefully we can come up with a program where we actually fund a second question. Put it out to the taxpayers. The taxpayers approve the second question. We have not assumed a dollar volume or value to this yet as far as what it would cost, but we're going to get there. So we'll find out what it's going to cost to have these panels put on the roofs. We'll find out what our technology and safety needs are, and assume a dollar value there. And hopefully, with the credits we'll receive over the life of the bond, it'll pay for itself. That's our wish, that's our goal, that's what we're working towards. So hopefully it'll pay for itself. And we're gonna learn as we go along. I don't have the answers, I don't pretend to. But this is the first step in many steps of finally creating a revenue-generating project for the Nutley Board of Education. So I'm excited about it, and we'll talk about it, and we'll hear about it shortly. I also want to thank Commissioner Petracco, who continues to work on the stop, drop, and go that we've discussed at Radcliffe School. We understand that we have a problem on Bloomfield Avenue. Nobody denies that we have a problem on Bloomfield Avenue with people and children crossing the middle of the street, cars flying by with literally no gap between the sidewalk and Bloomfield Avenue. It's been bothering me since my kids went to school there 20 years ago. And our goal is to take that out of the equation. We talked about putting a stop, drop, and go behind the school. It wasn't well received, but the concept was well received, moving the traffic away from Bloomfield Avenue. So we'll continue to look at the potential of other ideas or concepts that we can discuss. We've had the commissioner had Jack Barry do some investigative work, and he has just recently completed an evaluation of the traffic study on Bloomfield Avenue, so we'll hear more about that in our next meeting. And also, before I talk about construction, I just want to address, I know we raised 100% of the staff for this meeting. Association, the reason for that pricing. The board, we heard Bill mention today, just discussed the his audit. So we just received this audit back. Once we received the audit back, we found that we, including the $534,000 surplus, whatever it is to be exact, including that surplus, we're still $2.4 million short of the 2% cap that we need to meet for the 2011-2012 budget. We have a deadline of about less than 8 weeks from now where we have to submit a preliminary budget to the county. Didn't leave us any time at all to where to get together as a board and discuss how we're going to close that $2.4 million gap. So because part of what has to be discussed when you're talking budgets is personnel. So you can't discuss personnel without raising them. And that's why we raised everybody, because in all the board meetings that I've been to, this is my sixth year of board meetings, ultimately, it's a name always comes up in executive session when we're talking about personnel, and then somebody says, hold on, we didn't raise that person, you can't discuss that person in executive. So to eliminate that issue, we just raise the entire district. So my personal opinion, and it's just my personal opinion, you know, the reason why we just asked the high school staff if they would volunteer to do a zero period or a ninth period, and it came back 90% yes. The reason we did that is because we don't have the flexibility we need right now. Because we don't have enough teachers. We don't have enough classes. And we can't fund all of this with the budget constraints that are upon us today. So that's why we did what we did. And more than likely, it will happen again at the next meeting on January 10th. So that's why we simply move this out there. Okay, as far as moving into committee reports, I'll just start with a brief instruction report since it's getting a little repetitious. We are closing a lot of the gaps when it deals with construction in the district. The high school is, you know, most of the high school is under the first half of the HVAC. The new HVAC system is in progress. We are operating under the old system. So that's ongoing there. Lincoln, Washington, by the way, since we got pulled out the last month, I've spent a lot of time in the elementary schools making sure that the heat was operational. I've done my own heat studies with a thermometer in many classes just to make sure everybody's okay and comfortable, because some classes are warmer than others, some are cooler than others. Some operate differently. This belongs to the Nicoletti, so I don't know if there's a joke. Mr. Nicoletti, I have your thermometer there. So I'm very happy with where we are today. There's almost every building has new heat in it, and we seem to be having minimal issues when it comes to heat in our buildings. So everybody as of this week is comfortable, I think. We still have punch list work ongoing in Lincoln, Washington. Radcliffe, we're going to conclude some of the work that needs to be done during the holidays as we close for the next couple of weeks. So I would expect that 99.9% of the work will be concluded there. I actually walked that school the other day with the principal, and he assured me that 99% of the safety concerns have been addressed, and the one that remains will be taken care of for the holidays. Spring Garden School, that work continues. Again, minimal issues with heat. Most of it's okay. The gym is okay. The schools really look great. You guys have done a terrific job there. And still, with the most work to be done, I guess, is still again, we're continuing the cabinet work. And we will continue with punch list work throughout the balance of the year. And then within another month or so, the only items that should be remaining are the other 50% of the HVAC work to be completed with the high school. So, seeing that, does anyone else have any reports?
Yes, Mr. President.
Mr. Coker.
Thank you. I have two reports, one on technology, one on finance. Technology committee met with administration for the purpose of reviewing
reviewing where we, the status of the various projects which are in play this year. In the package, board members' package, you'll find status sheet and comments just to elaborate a little bit on what those projects are. I think that where we are at, I think we will accomplish this year the things that we said we will accomplish. Perhaps, Mr. President, that in January, maybe the second meeting in January, we have a brief presentation to the public to let them know what we are doing and things that we're going through. Fourth, planning a broader meeting in January after the holidays to talk about the content of what your projects are and the needs analysis, doing the needs analysis of where we want to go and the next steps. With respect to the Finance Committee, I think you mentioned a lot of what we talked about. We had the audit, the auditors came in and we went through the audit report. And again, I'd like to commend Mrs. Gaiman's on the fact that there were only five and they were non-reoccurring recommendations of the audit report. The key is that there were no recurring issues in that audit report. We reviewed the extended day program, they're on track this year financially. Come out in the black and pay the board for the facility costs that they owe us for last year and this year. We talked about briefly about the current fiscal year. We're on target to come in at budget, but it is very tight and we'll have to be closely monitored as we go forward. But we expect to come in. Final thing, and probably most importantly, we talked about next fiscal year budget. Ms. Yamin's put together a projection of cost current contract costs and certain increases that are recurring increases and $2,450,000 deficit that you mentioned earlier. We talked about administration put together a list of possible areas reductions in cost can be made, and that was included in the board members' package along with the budget comparison for the year. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Mr. Rosado.
Okay. Negotiations. The report that we are still ongoing with the custodial grounds and maintenance mediation, and we just started our negotiations with the administration, which we had a first meeting and. Also policy, we had first reading, last meeting, which we'll be reading our second reading for the, say about 24 that we have. A couple new policies that will be discussed tonight, and Robert will inform us of those on the policies.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Riley. Regarding the academic committee report, as a follow-up to last month's Board of Education meeting, the academic committee will be introducing two academic policies this evening for the first reading, that being the National Honor Society and the Advanced Placement Policy. As part of this committee report, I will be introducing the new criteria, my perspective, are intended to move our school district forward by increasing the educational bar for our students. I've also invited members from the high school administration to offer their perspective and weigh in on the discussion. That being Vice President Williams, Ms. Jill Gilliam, Director of Guidance, and Mr. Rick Hagel, co-advisor from the National Honor Society. The policies that I will be introducing in a few moments have taken a few months to develop. This policy development process involved numerous discussions with the high school administration, along with factoring and research from the surrounding schools, particularly Glen Ridge and Milburn serve as districts in the model of our AP policy. We start with the presentation. Okay. So we begin with the National Honor Society. Thank you.
demonstrate outstanding achievements in the following areas: scholarship, character, leadership, and service. And I'll have the administration weigh in on those specific changes, but with the new policy, we're moving from 3.5 to an average, and we're raising that to 4.0 GPA in order to gain acceptance in the national society. In terms of our discussion of the policy committee, trustees Pizzotto and trustee Rogers, we talked about the idea of revamping some of the service requirements. So now we have that committee will participate in at least 3 school service activities. They must complete a minimum of 12 community service hours, and that was a contribution by Mr. Rogers. Qualification established by the National Honor Society and chapter number 000662. And the induction ceremonies take place in the spring of the student's junior year. So in regard to our advanced placement policy, some of the board members. The high school administration and curriculum coordinators will introduce an application process for all students interested in enrolling in the course. That's a component of our policy. The application process will include evaluation of SAT, SAT scores, review of relevant courses, an essay or writing sample dependent on course discipline, a teacher interview and recommendation, and this is a new policy component that was introduced by the district of Milburn regarding this idea of signed parental consent form along with a signed student contract. AP students are required to take the AP exam in May. This was not the case prior. If they do not take the exam, they will not receive full AP credit or wait on their transfer. Students and families are responsible for all AP exams. And I'd like to conclude by saying that another school district is making definitive strides to embrace academic rigor and reward academic achievement. And also, I'd like to thank my fellow board of education members, Superintendent Barrett, administration of Nutley High School for their continued support throughout this process. I'll turn over the discussion to Mr. Williams.
Sure.
Thank you, Dr. Reed. On behalf of Mr. Cashman, I'd just like to make a couple of points. With Pat Camarda and Mr. Cagle here, 10 years experience in the as leaders of the National Honor Society, we have an emergent situation with the numbers in our National Honor Society. As stated on the slide, National Honor Society awards exemplary performance in leadership, character, service, and academics. However, what needs to be addressed maybe in the future is that we have an issue with our grading system. It has led to an increase in the number of students who are able to apply for the National Honor Society. We've seen this arithmetic increase really since the years 2006-2007. And while increased numbers may seem to be welcomed by some, we feel that it is not really necessarily a true and fair barometer of the true academic rigor and standards that should be awarded to somebody who is in the Honor Society. The past practice in Nutley High School, National Honor Society, has been relatively small, approximately 20% or below, give or take, of a graduating class. With the current requirement of the 3.5 GPA, this is no longer the case. We have had, like I said, an increase in the numbers coming in. To earn the mark of distinction, students have to be exemplary, as we stated in the following areas: leadership, character, service. We really hit that. And by the way, the recommendation was for 3 areas. Right now, we require 6. Student council, athletics, key club, interact, the culinary arts, the music programs already offer leadership and service requirements, which most of our students hit out of the ballpark. If you've seen our musical performances, you have seen our students do most of anything out there in a voluntary sense for the school community and the town community at all. They can gain, just for an example, 12 community hours participating in the Relay for Life, which is every June. Every May. So we do, I think, an exemplary job there already. It is in the academics that I think we need to match up that exemplary benchmark. The 3.5 current GPA requirement has led to skewed numbers, quite honestly. We feel that under the current grading system, we're not going to get a true reflection. That's why we're asking for a 4.0 requirement to restore the prestige and distinction that should be associated with the with membership in a National Honor Society. Again, Dr. Reed talks about academic rigor. You want to reward those students, the students who are usually in the top echelon academically. I would like to introduce Ms. DeVilio, Head of Guidance, to kind of fill out a bit of our presentation to kind of, she has a little bit a better sense of the numbers with the grade range.
Just to give you a little bit of history, in 2006, when the grading scale was changed, it was stretched out.
I'm sorry, can everyone hear her? But could you come to the mic first, just so, please, thank you.
In 2006, when the grading scale was changed, the grade scale was stretched out. And in doing so, we have a grade scale that tops out at 5.6 in an AP and 4.6 in a regular, and the honors is right in the middle. What happened in that year, the students, there was no phase in. There was an automatic switch. So a student, when Mr. Pierre-Marston and I looked at the data and the numbers to see where the benchmark of that 3.5 changed, a student that had a 3.1 GPA on Monday with the old scale before it was changed, as soon as they put this new formula into place, that next day on Tuesday, so to speak, that student with 3.1 was inflated to 3.54 automatically. So the 3.5, which was once a very high standard for someone coming into the National Honor Society, no longer is a high standard. It's really equivalent to a 3.1, which is a B minus. And we are not saying these students that are earning that 3.1, that new 3.5 are not working hard. But we're looking to honor the students that are really the top of the class, which really is, you know, it should be around that top 20%, which is consistent with a lot of districts around us. For example, last year's valedictorian graduated with a GPA of well over a 5. So if someone's graduating with a GPA over a 5, a 3.5 is considerably lower than what that high benchmark should be. We are making eligible nearly 50% last year were eligible to be in the Honor Society once they went through the other aspects of their character and leadership and community service. Some of them were weeded out, so to speak, but the percentage of acceptance I still think was near 35%, Mr. Pagel. So that is still well above that 20% average that the Honor Society is looking for. We are also not looking to take out that student that is a hardworking student that is not in honors classes. The student that is in regular classes from their freshman year all the way through their sophomore year is still eligible for the Honor Society. If you look at the GPA scale now, the regular scale, the 92, is our lowest A, which is a 3.8. They can earn as high as a 4.6. So an A student in regular classes is not gonna hang in there by the skin of their teeth with a 3.8 the entire time. They're gonna balance themselves out. So it is very cheap. We are not eliminating those good, strong students that are working hard and are maintaining that A average. What we are doing is we are raising the bar and recognizing the students that really, truly deserve the distinction of National Honor Society. We don't want to downplay what anyone else is doing in their studies throughout the year or over the course of their 12 semesters of high school to achieve this distinction. By having our GPA at 3.5 right now, we're bringing it down to the 50th percentile. So in doing so, we often have students that are enrolled in basic skills classes, whether it be for math or language arts. Sometimes they're struggling to make those proficiency levels in the HESPA. And again, they're working hard, they're achieving their personal goals, but that is not an Honor Society student. And we're looking to make our Honor Society students proud of being in the Honor Society because they have worked hard to achieve that, and they're really putting their best effort forward from the time they come into high school. Another important aspect is the students that are in the National Honor Society, because they are in that top portion of our class and they are challenging themselves academically, they are capable of fulfilling a service requirement, which is to tutor. So we need students in the Honor Society that fulfill that service requirement of tutoring other students. And again, with that 50% being eligible, those students that are making in that 50% are not always capable of tutoring other students in need. So we're really just trying to raise the bar and really increase the academic rigor and reward the students that are achieving that. We are not looking to downplay hard working student that's getting a B, because they are working hard. We're looking forward to, you know, get the right students in the honors. And Mr. Cagle is going to go through some of the equations, which only a math teacher can really explain.
I'd like to just go over a little of the history of how we got to this point in the last decade before I go on to that screen. In the early 2000s, the GPA requirement was 3.25. Mrs. Barnett and I looked at the percentage of the students who were meeting that. We were running about 37% of the junior class being able to get that particular GPA every year at that point. We felt that was too high for an honor society. So we asked for and were granted a 0.25 increase. We were not allowed to phase it in. We had to wait 3 years, in effect, for that to be put into place. In the meantime, our numbers creeped up from around the 70s area to the last year of that 3.25, we inducted 86. After it got raised to 3.5, we had 2 years at that level before the grading system got changed. In those 2 years, we dropped down to the low 70s. The year that the grading change took place, we went from the low 70s to 96 in that 1 year. The next year, we went to 125 being inducted. We dropped down to 95 the next year, probably due to a difference in class size. Last year we inducted 118. In that particular year, last year, exactly 50% of the junior class was academically eligible to get into the National Honor Society. We did not feel that that was representative of what an honor society should be. We've been asking for the past 3, perhaps 4 years to have this increased. We are asking it to be increased this year, effective at the beginning of the third marking period. As Ms. DeVilio mentioned, and I mentioned, the 50% figure from last year, this year I've projected our figures at 3.5 to be 44.1%. Those were numbers taken from what we would have after the first marking period. So with one additional marking period to be added to that, I don't expect that would change very much, if at all. 44.1% is still what we think is entirely too high. If we do go to the 4.0, which we highly recommend, it'll be 23.4% of this particular class. Now, we're too late for this particular class. The water is under the bridge as far as that's concerned. Well, what we would like to do is we would like to phase in. We would like the incoming freshman class for next year to be at 4.0, but we would like to phase in this year's sophomore class and this year's freshman class so that we can start to achieve some correction in our numbers. We are not asking that those two classes immediately go to 4.0. We know that would not be fair. What we are asking is that at the beginning of this third marking period, that those students do 4.0 work from that point on. And could you queue up the next one? All right, so I figured this out based on the fact that when a student is inducted as a junior, he has had 10 marking periods plus 2 exams. A marking period counts double what an exam does. So I, for lack of a better term, I call them grading units. Marking period gets 2 grading units, an exam gets 1. So 10 marking periods plus 2 exams gets you 22 grading units by the time they are academically eligible in the middle of the junior year. The sophomores have 4 marking periods plus an exam left. So that would be 9 out of 22 grade units. You take 9 over 22, you multiply it by the proposed increase of a half point, and the GPA increase should be 0.2045 for this year's sophomore class. Add that on to the GPA as now at 3.5. I rounded down so as not to eliminate anybody in a rounding process.
sophomore class. If they're at 3.5 now and do the 4.0 work that we are asking, that we're going to try to have put in, then they should be at a 3.704 next year. They'll still get in. The freshman class has 18 of those 22 grading units still left. They have two full years plus two exams. So 18 over 22 times 2.5 gets you a GPA increase of 0.090. So they would be accountable to have a GPA of 3.909. And this would bring them into the National Honor Society. And then this year's eighth grade class, next year's freshman class, the full 4.0. We would achieve some correction for next year, a major correction 2 years from now, and the full correction 3 years from now. And we could turn this back into National Honor Society. We have problems right now that have been previously mentioned. In each of the past several years, we have people that we induct in May, and we find out in June that they have not passed a portion of the HESCO. Now, I can see that that would perhaps happen perhaps once in a while. But when it happens every year, I think that's indicative of a problem here. Last year, three of them. To us, that's unacceptable. Found out today that one of the students who didn't pass last year's test in March and retook it in October of this year actually scored less, significantly less this year than last year when they took it the first time. I think that speaks for itself. We ask you to seriously consider raising the GPA to 4.0 and to seriously consider phasing it in immediately so that we can turn this back into a National Honor Society. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Any other comments at this point?
We can discuss it when we do the resolutions, the discussion portion of the resolutions.
Mr. Ross, do you have any other questions? Yeah, just a couple of things, Mr. President. We're working with the mayor's office on a food service provider on an effort to bring more healthier foods into the school district. And also, I want to forward to every one of our members a suggestion. Proposal I got from this is Sheila Dunn, who sits in our community. She is also proposing to assist us with health and fitness without any cost to the school district. So I'll get that to all the members in the next couple of weeks. That's all I have.
And anyone else? Seeing none at this time, I'd like to bring up Ryan Hall from Orion and John Chappelle.
Technology there, they want bottom lines to be sure.
it comes to solar, and feel free, please, ask any questions if you want. Anybody feel free to ask any questions. I'd be more than happy to answer them. Because when it comes to solar, once you're properly educated and you understand the financial benefits, the financial risks, it really comes down to why don't you do this? And the real reason people don't do this is because the roofing technology, as you mentioned earlier, may need to be replaced in 4 or 5 or 6 years. Therefore, the cost of putting solar panels on the roofing system, 4 or 5 or 6 years later, they have to take them off, re-roof the roofing system, put it on. In this particular instance, it's interesting that this year, you put on a new roofing system, and it has a 20-year life. So that means the investment in solar technology will reduce operating costs from an electricity consumption standpoint, and it'll also be a revenue generating source for your new energy products. So I'll also take a step back, and you're probably wondering, as you drive by, you see these solar panels on the poles, why people are doing this. And like I said before, it's not out of the goodness of their heart that they're doing this, they're doing it from a financial benefit. And that financial benefit stems from the governor of the state of New Jersey early in the 2000s, and the legislature created a mandate that the state of New Jersey generate, and the utility companies such as PSE&G, JCP&L, and Atlantic City generate or purchase solar-related energy, a certain percentage. To do that, they can either put these on light poles, like you see, or they can buy what are called solar renewable energy credits from people that put them on the rooftops. So if you're taking notes right now, that's something that you want to write down. It's solar renewable energy credits, which is an SREC. Okay? So over the last few years, they've ratcheted up on the demand that's required for the new purchase. So what does that mean? That means for each megawatt hour of solar that you generate, you generate what's called an SREC. Okay, so an SREC is a financial instrument that utilities will buy from the school district, therefore creating revenues. So the megawatt hour that you generate will be consumed and offset your electricity purchases, which is a good thing. So you invest some money, you generate some electricity, it goes into your building, you don't buy it from the utility, therefore you save money. That same credit then goes into a financial system where you sell them to utilities and they buy them from you for a certain amount of revenue. Therefore, from an investment standpoint, solar energy provides an incredible rate of return on your investment. And what's interesting is there's really a couple of different ways to go about it. One is putting your own capital and consuming the power and getting the quality internal rate of return. And the other is through what's called a solar power purchase agreement, or what's commonly referred to as a PPA. What's interesting in a PPA, what you'll see is some schools decide the PPA route, some schools decide the capital route, some companies decide the PPA route, some companies decide the capital purchase route. What's interesting in as a PPA is what that is a company like Orion will come and we'll invest in the technology, we'll put it on the rooftop, and we'll basically sell you the solar electricity for 6 or 7 cents a kilowatt hour. You're paying 9 or 10 cents right now. Therefore, you're generating free cash flow. What's interesting right now is the financial windfall, the financial benefits really matter to a company like Orion. So, with the school district and being able to leverage debt capital at cheap debt rates, you're able to then leverage your low interest rates on the cost of capital, and you're able to invest in technology to earn a rate of return. So, what we've done is we took a look at a few of the schools. There's a significant opportunity to generate ancillary revenue. Now, how much ancillary revenue that is will depend on how significant an investment that the school wants to make. So it really comes down to understanding from an energy input standpoint and a financial input standpoint and a financial output standpoint, and understanding the financial drivers that go about that. So I'm going to stop right there and kind of open that up for questions, because I know that was kind of
I think, as I discussed earlier, this is extremely preliminary. We don't have any numbers. So, you know, the next step, obviously, a lot of board members to ask about questions. Obviously, this would have to be put as an RFP. But we have to get a handle on what the options would be for the district in generating whatever amount of power we could in order to
at their school this year, and the Honors Associates at their building this year. There's a building out on Route 202, and Edmunds, I don't even know what it is, I think it's a pharmaceutical company, but they have just acres and acres and acres of solar panels that were just put up this year. There must be 5,000 solar panels on their front lawn. Recently, just here in Clifton, at the cemetery down in the cross street there, they just put solar panels on their lawn to generate the energy they need for their buildings. So I think it's really an interesting time. You know, there's state tax credits, there's federal tax credits, there's public service tax credits, and all that has to be tied into coming up with a number of what it's going to cost us if we look at over second question for a bond.
I know it's all preliminary, but I hope this will be one of the issues that we're looking at to share with the town. I hope they will make a presentation to the town also.
Yes, two separate entities, but maybe we can sell the entities to the town.
In some cases, but I think we can at least discuss with the town the possibility of sharing some of the cars.
But we are going to reach out to the commission.
Yeah, and I think, really, to address the core of what you're trying to get at is what would be the next steps if we were to take this in the future. And, you know, a company like Orion can easily look at the buildings, and we've already done that, and tell you approximately how much energy you can get on the rooftops, approximately how much it's going to cost, and approximately how much energy it's going to generate. And then it's just a matter of plugging in your financial metrics and knowing what kind of internal rates of return that you want as a board, what kind of internal rates of return you want on your debt capital, and then understanding what the financial risks are associated with the project. And then, of course, you can take a detailed engineering study, and then from the detailed engineering study, would then move to a request for proposal, and then you get hard and real numbers.
Anybody else have any questions?
Yes, sir. What's the projected lifespan of this thing?
That's a good question. The question was, what was the projected lifespan of this thing? And projected life comes in a warranty. So your warranty of a solar panel is twofold. One is you have material workmanship of the panel, and the other is you have a power warranty of the panel. So the short answer to your question is 25 years. Okay, the long answer to your question is every solar panel degrades over time. It's a semiconductor-based product, therefore heat will continue to degrade the product over time. So you get a power warranty. And what that power warranty means is that over 25 years, your power from the module won't have degraded more than 80%, and it's 90% of 10 years. So in your investment, that's why in the first part of my commentary was your roofing system is very important, because most of the time with solar energy systems, what fails is your roofing system and not the solar system. So what ends up happening is you have so many upgrades in 19, 20, 21, 22 years that it becomes economical for you to take it off and replace the roofing system. So it's a 25-year asset. Most of them have been accelerated life testing to go well beyond 25 years. It's just a matter of how much power is going to be produced in the market.
Yes, two questions. One, you mentioned that other districts have done this already.
Good question. So the question was, can you give us a hint on what the ROI is? And without putting in any specific tax benefits or specific grants, you're typically looking at between a 5 or 6 year payback. That's on a simple payback metric. So depending on your debt structure, if you were to float a bond, X percent, you can throw that, a letter of return on there. And that I don't have off the top of my head because my brain, maybe the math got it. So, but yeah, typically a 5 or 6 year payback. And then those are based on, and the reason it's between a 5 or 6 year payback is because your SREC benefit, which is your solar renewable energy credit, you have a low end projection and a high end projection. So it's in between there. And you can lock in values as you wish.
Thanks. The other question is, we did the, use our own capital.
Good question. So the question was if the school funded with their own capital, is our fee funded? And of course, we're a for-profit entity. So what we would do, and what a company like Orion would do, and we're not the only one that develops solar projects to help people save money. What we would do is we would come in, probably do a little bit of assistance in helping frame the project, and then it would go out to bid. After we helped make sure that it was logically framed in the RFP, making sure that we didn't forget to include stuff like the structural integrity of the roof and everything that we need to do, is what we would do is take care of all the permitting, all the interconnection agreements, all the project management, the installation, and then train your O&F, your operations staff, on common maintenance. And then either, if you wish, we can enter into an operation maintenance contract with you. But typically what we find is, especially with companies and entities such as yourself, you have the maintenance people on staff that can take care of it.
So you're sort of like the architect and CM.
Correct. I mean, it can function in many different ways, but most of the time you want to have somebody that can provide the turnkey delivery, because you need that single point of contact. And really when it comes down to a couple different things, it comes down to finding the right technology for the rooftop, because there's multiple technologies out there. And then the second thing is it's execution. So the execution part is really key, but most importantly is if you don't have the project framed right and it's not designed right, then it doesn't matter who's executing it, it's going to be a problem. School districts. The interesting thing with schools is they're under power purchase agreements. And typically under power purchase agreements, that's not Orion specialty. And under power purchase agreements, we can produce the power. So there's a few that we're working with and that we've decided to pass on just because we felt that that's not our specialty. So right now we're not including any school districts. Later, we were more focused just to give you guys a background about what's going on in the solar business. There's a federal tax credit that obviously applies to taxable entities, so there's a grant in the tax credit this year, so our company is more focused on the commercial cluster entities, and we still are focused on that as well, and helping for the
development.
So I just want to follow up on something Mr. Kuczynski just said. The Board of Commissioners and the Board of Education were working separately on idea of shared services. They have their committee meetings and they do their research. We have our committee meetings and we do our research. This could be a catalyst to do something very significant in 2011. I would propose that this Board of Education, the full body of nine, meet with the full body of five, the Board of Commissioners, in public session, and to have these presentations made and to get input from the public. Finally, as a body of 9+5, we start to move toward shared services. This is very significant. Solar energy in particular, can save us millions upon millions of dollars in years to come. So I would like now to have a discussion with our colleagues, if we could, about that idea. Could we possibly extend, and I think you already did at one point, can we extend our hand in a proposal to the Board of Commissioners to meet in the beginning of 2011 to discuss this issue of energy? We're at our township and our school district.
Well, I think that district is on a regular basis as that committee of going after shared services and talking on a regular basis. And once we get a better handle on what the costs are, then we can sit down. And I think ultimately we also have to come together and discuss these issues. It's a critical issue. So I'm all for it. But hold on, let's stay focused on this for now, on the solar. Yes, Paul.
Could you tell me about maintenance and repair? Who bears those costs? For how long? Is there any kind of warranty period, such as on a car? In like 3 years, you have bumper to bumper, so to speak?
Good question. The question, just to repeat it, was about warranty and who takes care of those costs. So it really depends on your RFP, what you want, and the request for proposal. A typical solar installation has a one-year workmanship warranty where the turnkey service provider takes care of all the issues. And then you can extend that if that's your desire. After that, you have two different maintenance items to think about. One is the solar modules on the rooftop, and the other is the inverter on the ground. converter on the ground is semi-annual preventative maintenance, and knowing that you have maintenance people on staff, it's not like a rocket ship. It's, you know, it's just coils and filters. Very simple for them to diagnose. They do it twice a year, and they just, you know, change filters if they have to, make sure that it's clear and debris. That's what they're doing on semi-annual preventative maintenance. On the roof, you're doing a walkthrough twice a year, basically looking at two things. One is you're looking at making sure no electrical connections got hit by, you know, some sort of trash bag that came on there, or some bird dropped a bone on something. The other thing you're looking at is how soiled the solar modules are and if cleaning would be necessary. So as you put together a detailed pro forma, is you want to put together reserves for cleaning, because you are going to have to clean these over time. Because what happens is, while we are in a state where we get precipitation, unlike, you know, Arizona or Southern California, what happens is you tilt a flat panel, and there's no different technology where your flat panel, you tilt it at 15 degrees, what happens is the rain will then wash the panel, right at the bottom of the panel, you will get a throw on the panel, so therefore it will need to be cleaned. So that's really, from a cost standpoint and time standpoint, that's really what your major investment is in O&M. And that's really a decision based on the visual, you know, what you see, and then how your system's performing over time. So in a couple of years, if you notice that your system's not performing at the par, and you call me and you said, I think there's something wrong, I would say, you know, how do you look at the modules lately? That's when you're cleaning that system. And then it's just a cost benefit.
What is the longest time period you've had one of these installations operation?
Solar installs in New Jersey have been,
no, I mean, for your company.
For our company, 2 years.
2 years weekly, almost.
Correct, 2 years. We've primarily been energy efficiency. And then what's happened, just to give you a background on solar, maybe this would be good for you, just so you understand. What happened is, you know, in the early 2000s, solar was really only viable in California and southern Arizona, and really that was because of the sun incentives. And then they started to come out with some technologies in the middle of 2005. The challenges was they were having to penetrate the deck, and most of our customers that we were doing business with didn't want to penetrate their roofing systems. And then in early 06 and 07, was really when the balancing systems came out, and that's when we started to get into solar. We've been researching it for the last 10 years. The challenge is the technology really hasn't come down there. And then in 09 and 10, prices have came down to where now you can get a reasonable return on investment with, and sometimes without, a significant amount of subsidies. So.
Yeah. One question, I know you shared services is a separate topic, but the question is, certain projects, the economies of scale, you did 5 buildings, you did 7 buildings, it really makes a difference on the marginal cost of the buildings.
Is
that similar in this, or
are
buildings sort of, the cost is independent,
you know,
it's the building cost that particular
building is expensive? So the question was, do you get economies of scale for more buildings, more projects? I say yes, but I caution you, and I'll kind of give you an example. So, for instance, on a project, you have to do an independent structural analysis. So if the building is 10,000 square feet, or if the building is 100,000 square feet, the structural review is basically the same cost. So what I mean by that is, if you start adding smaller buildings, and if you're adding more projects, then you're adding more cost to the project. So in a sense, if you can add buildings of scale, and then you're much better. The other thing is, from an installation standpoint, the smaller you go, the more fixed cost you have for the building. So that's the issue, is you can add more buildings and get economies of scale on the procurement side, but on the installation side, you really get very little leverage. Because if you think about it, this building's on this side of the road, that building's on that side of the road. Bring a guy up here, bring a lift up here, put the modules on, he's got to tie in over here. Same thing, he's got to do over there. He's got to get a permit for over here, he's got to get a permit for over there, he's got to get an interconnection loop over there, he's got to get an interconnection loop over there. So while you can get someone to get some scale, it's not as much as we typically find in certain projects we've seen in the past.
So waiting for somebody else is necessary.
Yeah, and the other thing about waiting for somebody else, and that I've caution you is, I have a lot of customers that wait to do projects all the time. And solar is something that's interesting where you kind of start to get a time clock ticking with your roof. And not to say that, you know, like a one-year-old roof is worse than a zero-year-old roof, but a two-year-old roof. But what happens is customers, you know, they start to wait, and then you start to, you know, to go back to your question is, how long do these things last? You know, you start to go, well, we just did our roofing this year, and now we're going to try to wait to get a bigger project next year, And by the time you end up physically doing something because you've got everybody on board, the challenge becomes, now you have a three-year-old roofing system, is it going to last for the next 20 years, and there's your economic projections going to change. So while you can get scale, you also can delay it, timing issues with your own system.
I want to bring John at this point because John, one of the reasons that he's here, he doesn't even know, the three reasons he's here. He happens to be the vice president of commercial business for this area. So to answer Steve's question and Charlie's question, one of the reasons that John is here is because John, being the manager of commercial business, deals with our commissioners all the time. So he's had many discussions with our commissioners about this product as well. So just a little overview of that as well as the, you know, what you want to talk about as far as your credits.
Well, basically overview, I've had the same conversation with all the 2G, where we're going to keep the same type of program, same information exchange. And it really depends on, you know, the availability of the roofing, type of materials, you know, and just whether the schools were better fit because of the brand new roofs. I don't know quite well. And the only way public service gets involved, we have a solar loan program. So when you're looking at, you know, you get a developer, you get your costs. Where public service comes in, we offer a loan where you pay back the loan with your SRECs. And the SRECs are floating, they're traded on the market, or the market they're trading. Right now they're trading for around $600. Get a loan through PSCG, we guarantee you a floor price. So we finance up to 60% of your project, and we guarantee you a floor price that's $375. And most loans that we've done are paid back in 8 to 10 years because of the SREC value. And then when you go through PSCG or go through the developer, part of the government program in New Jersey is you qualify for net metering. So when you hook the system, each school or whatever building you put a solar installation, you qualify for net metering. So even on a Sunday when you're generating power, your meter will spin backwards. So you know during the week, sunny day, using a lot of load in the schools, you're offsetting the cost from the utility. Maybe you're not generating 100% of your electricity, but whatever you generate is being used by the school. If you have to get some in from the utility, the meter spins on an inward basis. You net in. On a Saturday, Sunday, there's nothing going on in the school, you're generating power, that meter spins backwards. So now if you were just generating this electricity, selling on the open market, you're probably getting 2 to 3 cents a kilowatt hour. Because you're qualified for net metering, you're spinning backwards, you're getting back at 15, 16 cents if you've already given the utility. Your goal, it's almost like with the government, with your income tax. At the end of the year, you're really looking for a net gain of zero. You can't put a system in that's larger than generate, which you wouldn't anyway because your roofs are not big enough. So part of our goal is, and developers, they'll size the system based on your usage, your pickup unit, and your kilowatt hours. So that at the end of the year, you really want to offset your utility usage. The key is not to generate power. And then you have to qualify as a power generator, you have the connection agreements for power and from. When you go through New Jersey with the net metering, that's where the biggest savings are. And then, I know Carney put in a large system, they only put in a large system. So I can get probably contacts in some of the larger schools that have done solar installations, and we can get a conversation going and see, you know, the pros and cons of how their system is working out. And then we work with the installer as far as getting the permits hooked up with the hand meters and keeping track of the installation.
Any questions?
The key is, I've coached with Ken a long time, that's why I volunteered to come down. I work with O'Brien and Anheuser-Busch,
some projections, then we can work with you with the actual usage and see what kind of financing we can do best. And I could bring people from public service, the loan side, to sit down and really, you know, lay out the model that we use and look at it.
Thank you very much. Really appreciate the time.
First, but not Vice President yet.
Awesome.
Major Captain.
To me, you're president.
I've actually had this customer, you know, of this report authority and has a board of optimal ownerships. So, you know, solar, wind, and right now we're looking at trying to get some CNG up and running with fresh natural gas vehicles. We're working with the city of Newark to get their bus fleet on the fresh natural gas. But I keep Mr. Riley, I have a couple of people on our energy link. So any of the programs we're coming out with, we have some filings for more energy conservation programs, direct install, where we're going to be able to lease properties to install our own solar systems that we can pay your rent every month. Anything that comes out, I will keep you up to date.
We have a lot of losses for that, so we can offset the gentlemen, thank you very much. Very sense.
Okay. Now come to the portion of our meeting where we allow members of the public to address the board in this section. We allow questions and comments on resolution items only. Board regulations allow 20 minutes for this communications. Each person shall be limited to 3 minutes and we ask you to stay within this requirement. Speakers may speak more than only once. After all the floor of the person to speak on the topic at the meeting. The statements will be directed to me as the chair. No one may address board members individually. Right, when you come to the microphone, please say your name and address. We want to see your resolution items on. What was that? Where's the sound?
Son, I would like to draw your attention to BA Resolution Number 19, Renewal Fees. This represents a very generous reduction in fee on behalf of my attorney, Patrick Toscano, and myself. This is a reduced reimbursement for attorney fees that resulted from frivolous and unfounded charges of ethics violation filed by 5 individuals. The School Ethics Commission ultimately and completely dismissed these vacuous charges. What is of more importance is that they reached their decision to dismiss these ridiculous accusations within moments of concluding their hearing, which is unheard of in the history of the School Ethics Committee. It would almost be laughable if it were not for the fact that it cost another school district and ultimately the taxpayers $18,000. These false charges were the result of a group of people to drive a politically driven smear campaign to damage my name and reputation. These people responsible for this frivolous complaint and ultimate loss of $18,000 from the taxpayers of Nutley are Jerry Parisi, Sal Alamo, Maria Alamo, Jerry Del Tufo, and Jim Cook. These individuals signed an ethics complaint against me with absolutely no knowledge, proof of evidence, or any other facts that these allegations were true. As a matter of fact, when it came time to testify under oath, not one of these individuals offered their testimony, any evidence that supported their claims. Each one in turn testified that they had no knowledge of any information, conversations, or meetings between myself, the board attorney, Mr. Joe Zara, and any other person involved in the Tri-Tech settlement. They each testified under oath that they were not privy to any conversations or information, yet they each signed a complaint. This is most interesting because Mr. Kupka actually voted to accept the very settlement he alleged was arrived at for unethical behavior. More importantly, if Mr. Kupka and Maria Alamo, who sat on the board at the time, she signed a complaint, had withdrawn their complaints after the 3 co-complainants had signed theirs, the board of attorney may have been able to represent them. This would have saved the taxpayers these fees and saved me from the empty accusations that were politically motivated. Board counsel could simply have explained to the complainants that not only did Mr. Zara attend the meeting in Mr. Pomaco's office on the very morning of the settlement meeting, but he knew of the meeting with Tri-Tech and their attorney later in that day and just chose not to attend. Mr. Kupka and Mrs. Alamo's actions prevented this and forced me to seek private representation from the Toscano law firm. It was apparent then, it is abundantly clear now, that their actions were politically motivated. While they failed to produce any evidence or testimony to support their claims, they succeeded in spreading vicious rumors of wrongdoing and even suggested criminal activity. They even attempted to circulate a second letter full of false accusations that came to the attention of my attorney, Mr. Patrick Toscano. Mr. Toscano promptly informed the authors of such letter, Mr. Del Tufo and Mr. Olivo, what would occur if either of them attempted to circulate this libelous and false letter. Surprisingly, they did not circulate the letter. However, it was referred to in several gatherings during the last DOA election, but that's not what I'm here for. What makes this more outrageous is that they had no regard for the cost of the school district as long as they achieved their political goal. Further, it's come to my attention that the attorney they hired to prosecute this case was paid for by funds raised by other elected officials and a prominent business owner of town, and no one has come forth to deny this allegation, and this has been confirmed by the council. Parisi, Olivo, Alamo, Del Tufo, and Cook have brought these frivolous charges for political reasons at no cost to themselves. Yet, it cost the school district $18,000. This is especially troubling during these difficult economic times when school districts are struggling to reduce their budgets without compromising education. This fact weighed very heavily when Mr. Toscano and myself sat down and discussed our considerably generous reduction in fees. These five individuals owe an apology to the taxpayers of Nutley. It's one thing to finance your own political activities. It's quite another to practice such reckless behavior and then hand the bill to the taxpayers. Personally, I'm not surprised by their actions, having served with them on the board and seen them in action before. Most interesting, though, is the release form they requested I sign to expedite payment. It seems that they realized the liabilities resulting from the political witch hunt. But, as I stated in February, when the Ethics Commission ruled that I acted responsibly within my duties as the board president and committed no ethics violations, I simply wish to put this matter behind me. I want nothing further from these people other than the assurance that they will perhaps not be so hasty to attempt political character assassination at the peril of the school district and the taxpayers in the future. And their actions cost nothing in other ways. It's because of political shenanigans like this that good people do not want to come forward and put themselves in peril to serve the district. Thank you.
Anyone else wish to be heard? Resolution item zone.
Second, Mr. President. Al Thomas, 08 Kennedy Street. Mr. President, with regard to Board Secretary's resolution number 9, I'm curious what exactly was the meaning of the auditor's report that required corrective action, particularly recommendations number one, Roman number one, and Roman number 3-1. I mean, the impression I have reading, correct me if I'm wrong, is that we were not using standard operating procedures. And that we have not been sending the state controller contract award over $2 million to the Court of Appeals by state staff.
So would you like to respond to the state trust for us?
Either what?
With respect to recommendation number one regarding the standard operating procedure manual and the decision to small buffer, those all came about as part of the new accountability regulations, and the deadline to have them in place was December 30th, 2009. So this is an item that I inherited in my legal process. They are works in progress, they just have not been completed. They will be completed. With respect to
followed up on. I know Mr. Chambers will take care of everything in person, but it just seems to me that someone else needs to watch, you know, Mr. Chambers' office to make sure that or something got to get to the job offer for me out here. The next board administrator, who will be the chair?
I would answer your question this way. As Mr. Cook just said earlier, it's the first time in a while that we haven't had any recurring problems. So the fact that we don't have any recurring problems is very concerning. And I would respect, first of all, there's no policies in place because it's not a board function or a board member function to run the schools. Function policy to make sure that the schools are well run. That means you hire the people to trust to, and then you can trust your faith, trust in them to get the job. We don't micromanage personnel, we're not commissioned from board members. So, you know, that's why we have auditors and that's why we constantly review these annually.
Thank you, Mr. President.
I'm going to just be here.
Robert Mazzanello, 3235 President, Mr. President, members of the board, Mr. Senator, I'd like to discuss some of the policies mentioned in Board Resolution number 11, second reading. The first one is policy 5512.01, policy on harassment, intimidation, and bullying. And having read the current policy many times, I was wondering if someone could comment on the differences between the current policy and the new policy.
Mr. Susato, will you address that?
You want to address that? I would like to actually speak. We're going to have to know if he has a exactly what the question is here.
Mr. Mazzanello, along with this policy is a set of procedures that have been created by our committee as well as the superintendent school. Now, those procedures are going to require a lot of accountability. In the event a student is harassed or particularly bullied, there will now be a paper trail. That paper trail will begin from the first time, let's say, in elementary school. It will be put in a file, it will be in the superintendent's office, and then all through the tenure of the student's stay at the Nutley School District, that will obviously be something they can refer to in the event there's a second or third incident. In that policy, administrators and staff will be required to fill out particular forms that are going to be put in the superintendent's office. We didn't have that. We certainly didn't have a policy that mandated a procedure that would require that.
That's why I was asking, because the current 11-page policy is very general, it seems.
Yes.
It refers to wishes and hopes and things like that, as opposed to, like you say, having a list of things that
are required. What we've got there is a boilerplate policy from Strauss, and it's used all over the state. But we, and unfortunately, I guess you know, you weren't here at the last meeting, we actually put together a procedure that is going to be followed now by the district, a very comprehensive one, and I'm sure Mr. Zarek can get that to Mr. Rosenthal. I think he'd be pleased with that.
Yeah, I had a family emergency the last year, so I said,
Okay. So in fairness to you, I just have one point here.
All right, thank you very much. The second policy I refer to is policy 8461, reporting violence, vandalism, alcohol, and other drug abuse. And I have read through and understand the bulky EVVRS user manual, but in principle it's very simple because it just requires and I'll just take a quick minute to read a paragraph or so from Public Law 18A accordance with standards established by the commissioner, file a report describing the incident to the school principal in the manner described by the commissioner, and a copy shall be obtained from the forward to the district superintendent. The principal shall notify the district superintendent of schools of the action taken regarding the incident. Annually, at a public hearing, the superintendent of schools shall report to the Board of Education all acts of violence and vandalism which occurred during the previous school year. Verification of the annual report on violence and vandalism shall be part of the state's monitoring of the school district. And the State Board of Education shall adopt regulations that impose a penalty on the school employee who knowingly files the report, falsifies the report. The Board of Education shall provide ongoing staff training and so on and so forth. Anyway, that's 18A of public school safety law. In referring to the administrative code, chapter 16, subchapter 6A, 16-5-3, and I'd just like to read a couple of things from this. It again refers to 18A, and then it goes on to say, that the form shall be on a form adopted for such purposes by the district board of education. The form shall include all of the incident detail, offender, victim information that are reported on the victim violence reporting system. For each incident violence, the report of violence management, et cetera, and then it gives you a whole list of things, and that talks about the chief school administrator annually shall submit a report to the commissioner, blah, blah, and all that. And then it goes on to say, an annual hearing held pursuant to NJSA 18A, the chief school administrator shall report to the district board of education all acts of violence and vandalism and the proceeding, and it goes on and talks more about that. So my concern is, as there is a basis in the law and administrative code, just how important is it to this board of education to take seriously the requirements of the laws and of the code when developing this new policy?
Mr. Resnolo, this board takes policy seriously. The only thing we have control over as a board members is policy. We don't control personnel. We don't control day-to-day operations. We don't control cash flow, bank deposits, boilers, heat, any of that. What we care about is this. So the reason that you heard what you heard from Mr. Rogers today is because we do care about it. We could have just taken the Strauss SMA updated policy and read it and it would have been done. That's not what we did here. We tweaked this policy because we know how important it is to us. We know how important violence is. We know how important bullying is. We know how important reporting these incidents is. So I hope that answers your question.
Well, in fact, I just amplify one more thing I want to say about the importance of this. Mr. Resnolo, we did something that I don't think any other school district in the county has done, as far as I know. We have built into our memorandum of understanding with the prosecutor's office the reporting of harassment, intimidation, or bullying, and vandalism, for example. That memorandum was primarily focused on drug abuse and other things that would disrupt the school environment. So now, if a student is bullied, for example, during school, that report is going to be sent to the police department. Now, on the converse side of that, during off school hours, if the police come involved in a situation where they're in contact with a juvenile who has been bullied and make an arrest, the school district's going to be notified. So it's a very serious, we're all very, very concerned about it. It's very serious to us. So that's how far we've gotten with this.
Well, I'm glad that Mr. Riley and you, Steve, responded in the way that you did, because I know that that's true. And I know that you take this very seriously. And as a Board of Education, you're trying to do the right thing for our young and our families. What bothers me, though, is that when there are such things that happen in the school, and people have general knowledge of them and are required to respond.
With all due respect, we've been very lenient here. We're on our 15 minutes now. I understand your point, as you've made it many times before.
And
we
just wanted to say in conclusion that I appreciate that you allowed me to make it as I was going to ask. And I'm going to continue to make it with more.
what plans do you have in order to address those types of...
Well, that's an intervention on the part of the chief administrator.
I don't think that any parental letter or phone call goes unexamined. Certainly, we would take the appropriate action.
So, dismissal or removing that particular person from that position?
Well, then we get into the council for advice concerning that people who have. I'm on the council 2-3-4 times a day on a variety of issues, and so that would be a common part of the issue. And we would certainly take his advice. These are all personnel issues, and as such, I don't have any impact on you.
That's under procedure, not policy.
Right. The references you made, you made to it.
No, we would only be made procedure, not policy.
Well, there's no procedure here. That's why I read
Mr. Zara.
Yes.
Remember, Mr. Palombo, I don't know. We already have a procedure on reporting anything like that that goes to the press, isn't it, Chris?
Yes, sir. First, as you can imagine, there's parental contact. And then also, anybody who has a serious injury, not necessarily concussions, even an ankle, an elbow, shoulder, they cannot return to practice or competition until they are cleared by an MD.
It's duly noted. We can revise, but we're going to do a second reading. I'm not going to pull it. We'll move it forward because it's going to move forward tonight. But then we can revise it. I guess the chairperson, Mr. Stizzato, to revisit that for revision based on Mr. Thomas's ethics standard.
Just one more comment. On policy 4159, push that number slash school district reporting responsibility. As a 14-day reporting requirement for any arrest or offense for a site, arrest for a criminal or a crime or an offense or an indictment. I think that's, that may be fine for your indicted taxpayer. But I think there were a few crimes. If there were 14 days reporting requirement, it's an awfully long period of time. And I don't know if this is based on state law, based on contractual obligations, whatever, but that certainly seems like an awful long time. Sometimes, I'm sure we've all been there.
other discussion? Mr. Sauter?
Yes, I have a question. Maybe you can answer this for me. It seems I recall that at one time, the Honor Society was limited to 15% of the class. Is that true?
I don't think.
Mr. Sauter, I don't believe that's one of the superintendent resolutions. Can you refer to the resolution, Mr. Edmonton? What number?
Board resolution.
So first we're going to pass the shot in chance and get to that one entirely. Okay. That's a board secretary resolution, not a superintendent resolution.
Oh, okay. So that's all right.
Okay.
Ask that question. Okay.
Yes, sir. Any questions on 1 through 18? This is Russo.
Yes, I'd just like to point out, I'm already voting no on number 17, pre-approved trip list. I don't see how it's possible that we can pre-approve a trip that occurred on December 9th.
Did you repeat that, Mrs. Russo? Speaking to the microphone, we're not hearing that one, so.
Superintendent Resolution Number 17, approval of field trips. The paper, as I'm reading it, says pre-approved trip list. I'm going to be voting no on that because I can't pre-approve a trip that already occurred on December 9th.
Any other discussion?
Yeah, Mr. Riley.
Mr. Spizzato.
Number two, do we need to modify number two of the superintendent's
Okay, so we're going to revise superintendent's resolution number two to be effective February 10th, 2010. I'm sorry, 2011. Any other discussion? Call the roll, please.
Yes.
Lower than what we have at this point. I remember many years ago, we used to have two different inductions, if you remember, one for juniors at the end of their junior year, and the seniors that did not make it in the junior year, they were inducted in the fall of their senior year, so they could still put it on their college transcripts, if you remember that. I never remember such a low GPA, or such a low percentage. The lowest I could think of maybe was 25%, which which is pretty much at par with the national standard, because the national requirement is a 3 out of 4 all, which is about 25% of the eligible class. I can go back and check it, but that's...
Well, this might have been before you were involved, you know,
Perhaps. I've been the advisor since 1994. I've been there for a few years. And I don't remember this law. The lowest number of inductees, I remember, were in the high 50s, low 60s, which is about half of what we have now. Now we're talking about 120, 115, which is quite a change.
Can I ask one more question?
Certainly,
Mr. Zara. Mr. Zara, you can answer this question. We're talking about the AP courses. It's my understanding that legally any child can take any course in the school if they really want to or demand it. Is that true or not true?
Yes or no? I think parents certainly have a right to lobby for replacement. What we do have prerequisites, as you know. We also have the recommendations.
Oh yeah, I understand that.
But I think that the administration and the guidance counselor would be very firm in their recommendation that child not take that course. I think essentially, unless there is policy to the contrary, everybody in fact could make a strong case for being included in that course.
Right. It may not be advisable, but they can do it.
And if I could answer statistically, hopefully shed some light on your question. Milburn does not have a National Honor Society. They honor the top 10% of their class. Glenridge, they induct about 24%. Cedar Grove, 15%. Ridgewood, about 25%. Livingston, about 25%. Just for sake of comparison.
Mrs. Russo, you have a question?
Yes, allow me to go in reverse order. On number 20, did we discuss this at the beginning of the meeting? Because we couldn't really hear if this was in part of the report, Mr. President. That's the proposed 7-Eleven.
I can't hear your question. Could you speak into the microphone, please?
I'm sorry, what? I can't hear you. We don't hear
you. He couldn't hear your question.
Mrs. Russo, can you please repeat your question into the microphone? I can't hear you.
Item number 20, the proposed 7-Eleven. Did you discuss this in the beginning of the meeting with your report? If you did, I apologize, I couldn't hear you.
Yes.
You have a question on it?
Could you give me a two-sentence synopsis of your discussion?
Would you like me to explain the issues on that? Mr. Russo, the variance required for that project requires a parking issue. There's a fence that they're proposing to put up. The parking that they're proposing on the side of parking, the down spots. I don't even remember. There's a couple other variances that are required, but definitely a parking issue which we have concerned at the school. You know, the principal from high school in Castleton has some issues with it, which we made former chairman of the board. I also have concerns, which I will be representing the board that night after being on that committee and to hear what's going on. But there's a lot of parking issues, some fencing issues that are coming up that require variances.
Okay, thank you. I have another question. Excuse me?
Please ask your question.
Thank you. Number 12, adoption of bylaws, specifically the National Honor Society selection. This proposed policy, as read, is flawed as it does not meet the requirements established by the National Society. It surpasses them so much so that it should be read the National Exclusionary Society or National Perfectionist Society. The national standard says the minimum GPA at 3.0. Our requirements are already well above the minimum stated at a 3.5, and and we currently discredit all those students that do take part in community activities. Do we not wish to honor those students that are achieving success simply because there are too many of them? Why would we want to remove this opportunity for acknowledgement of hard work, good character, and leadership for many of our students? This will have a negative impact on college admissions when compared with schools across the country that accept the 3.0 as a standard. A 4.0 is far too high, then a fair compromise would be a 3.75. Thank you.
Any other discussion?
Two issues. Number 11, we talked about, I would like to obviously revisit that bylaw concerning the duties of the president and the vice president.
Again, that would be under revision, and we'll move forward tonight.
But I agree.
We should discuss that with the chair first.
And on 19, I'll vote no.
19. Again, anyone else? So, yes, sir. Yes, Mr. President.
I want to weigh in on the National Honor Society presentation tonight. First of all, I had, in the beginning when Dr. Reed had first discussed this, I kind of thought, well, maybe we've gone too far too fast. Maybe some of the expectations were too high. Maybe we were excluding some numbers of students. I had a lot of maybes, I had a lot of questions, but I've got to tell you, one of the things that Dr. Reed did was, we did several things, but one of the things that I had asked him to do, and he did, went to the professionals. He went to the professionals, he asked the staff members, the principals, he asked the people who gave the presentations here this evening, the superintendent of schools. He went outside the district, and to my surprise, he even went to Glen Ridge, and I think they were ranked number 5 in New Jersey Monthly rankings last year. And he did his homework. He did his homework, and he brought to us, at least to my satisfaction, enough information to give me a second thought on this entire concept of raising the bar. Now, Mrs. Russo might have, you know, a legitimate reason why she wants to look at that 3.75. But you know what? In life we negotiate, and in life we compromise. So it may be a good idea to look into that, but overall, the policy that was crafted primarily by Dr. Reed and the staff, I think is good for this district. Look, we have, when I say we, all of us, have, we've been like the hue and cry, like the town criers of old, crying about rankings and scores and academics and curriculum. And I've got to tell you, since I've been on this school board, I would say, venture to say, unless I have a memory lapse here, that this is the first significant, and when I say significant step towards getting our academics back in order. This is a good thing for the district. Now, I'm not an educator, so I can't tell you the specifics of how this will impact overall in years to come. But I would say this, one concern I had, among others, was are we going too far, too fast, and what did these individuals do, the professionals do? Teachers and the administrators and the superintendent and Dr. Reed, they worked on a program to phase this in over a period of time. So I want to just commend Dr. Reed and the administrators for the job they did. I like what I see here, but there's always room, and this is why we have these public meetings to discuss this. So if there are people that have concerns about it, bring it forward to the board. It's something I want. I learn from the public. I learn from every person I speak to. I've spoken to people over the past few weeks that are for this and against it, and they all have good, legitimate reasons. But overall, I think it's a good plan, and I would recommend we go forward with it at this point.
Any other discussion?
Mr. Cagle, I'd like to commend you for doing a real nice job on that pro-rata system you did, too. I think that would work out very well.
May I make one point?
Sure.
In regards to Mrs. Russo's question about the 3.0 and where we want to go, the 3.0 that the national organization recommends is out of a 4.0 scale. We max at 5.6 in this school. If you project the 3.0 over of a 4.0, into the 5.6, it would actually come to 4.2, proportionately speaking. So we are not even asking to go up to what legitimately we could ask it to go to. We want to keep it at 4.0 because we do not want to exclude the regular education student. We want to give them sufficient room so that they can make the honor society also.
Thank you very much. Any other discussion? All right, 3 points I want to make in closing before we vote on this. On resolution number 10, acceptance of donations from Spring Garden PTO. Again, thank you so much for the PTO, Spring Garden, stepping themselves again for $1,600 for the laminator. Thank you for that. We thank our State University Network for Educational Renewal for their $300 grant for the High School Study Room for the Educators Roundtable. And on resolution number 19, just wanted to be stated for the record that the $18,000 negotiated settlement, $6,000 of that money came from the insurance company. So the board is paying $12,000 of that $18,000. Call roll, please.
Mr. Popato.
Yes.
Mr. Kaczynski.
Yes, all items except for resolution number 19, I vote no. Bigger problem than just the membership requirement of the Honor Society. Also regarding policy 8461, I think we should have part of the policy be that the report that those statements posted on the school website. I would think that should be a standard inclusion of any policy. That's not already in the professional desire thing. The board at the website, the reports that go to the state, like some public record, should also be put on the website. And I think that's just to be standard operating procedure. I'll step aside and get that.
Anyone else have a question on the school?
also, I mean, we start talking about the concussion policy in Portland to business. I know the policy says that the school physician must approve the policy so the board approves it. I'm wondering if that has occurred, and if so, is that recorded in the memo or letter on file from the school physician saying that the policy is approved to it?
I'm definitely not sure the answer.
Regarding policy 6422, is the provision, this is on budget transfers. The provision has is a provision of policy that allows the superintendent to make budget transfers subject to ratification by the board. I'm wondering if our superintendent ever made such a transfer.
Not to my knowledge. I've certainly never ratified it.
And nor will I attempt to.
But he's certainly qualified.
I'm just wondering, because I've never seen all the resolutions on transfers, I've seen, never seen one clarification. And I was most curious to read policy 6360. Pull out. Well, it has more to do with what's there. I heard that Mrs. Posada said that you will be going to the zoning board meeting to speak on behalf of the board in opposition to the 7-Eleven application. I'm wondering, how did Mrs. Posada get appointed to speak on behalf of the board and not see a vote for the board? I can't think of anyone more qualified since he's a running zoning board, but I'm just wondering, what is the procedure by which someone is
the president? President selects all the committees. And I'm good on that. That's the best how it goes, whether it's finance, or zoning board, or planning board, or athletic, or facilities, whatever. Negotiations.
Okay, but this is talking about now representing the board or the public forum. Speak on behalf of the board. So in virtue of his office, as chairman of the
board representative of the zoning
committee.
By the way, I didn't say I was going to speak. He said I would be there representing the board.
Well, I'm just.
By the way, you could imagine, you know where this is, right? Where this spot is that they proposed to put this on.
No, I agree.
Next
TD Bank, very frustrated from high school, the kids across the street all the time.
I assume there was not a
very bad location. Could you imagine people coming in and out of that parking lot all day long for the kids running across the street?
I think it's a terrible location for a 7-Eleven. I'm just questioning the procedure by which someone would attend on behalf of the board.
Are you going to leave that meeting as long as you can?
No, I'm afraid not.
Any other questions? Okay, any old business?
Yes, Mr. President.
Mr. Rogers.
Tonight is the first I'm hearing again of the stop, drop, and go issue. I actually thought the business of that was dead and buried, but just for clarification, can you share with me, Mr. President, what is on the table now so that I can bring that information back to the parents of the school that I represent?
Well, I don't think it's ever been dead and buried. I mean, myself and the superintendent attended a meeting with you and Mrs. Russo and the PTO. And at that meeting, I said that we were going to investigate it further, that that it didn't seem or appear that the people were in favor of having something behind the school. So I asked that night if anyone from the PTO wanted, including the co-presidents, to be part of my committee with Commissioner Petracco to investigate alternative areas for the stop, drop, and go. As a matter of fact, that night at that PTO meeting, we spoke about the potential for having something on Chestnut Street. In fact, that maybe we could make it one way. It was out of the board's hands. It's really a commission item. And since then, the commissioner has gotten the assistance of Mr. Barry to do a study there, which I should have the results any day now, and I'll forward a copy of the same to you as soon as I get it.
Okay, so we could safely say that the proposal, or the alleged proposal, to have the stop, drop, and go actually constructed behind the school is dead. That's gone. That's not going to be resurrected. So what you're talking about is a public safety issue on Chestnut Street.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Any other old business? Any new business? Mr. Russo, old business? I'm sorry.
Old business. At the August 23rd meeting, I brought up a proposal to expand our extended day program. I questioned this at our last meeting. We were waiting on an answer from council. Do we have an answer from council
at
this time?
If I may? Sure. Yes, I did speak with Mark Wenzel last week, and he sees no issue in running that program during vacation and summer. There may be some change in language as far as the description of the program, but no restrictions.
Any other questions?
Yes, Mr. Wilson.
Yes, to piggyback on Mr. Rogers' question with safety and travelers around our schools, I attended the Lincoln School PTO meeting on Mr. Sposato's behalf. And parents there as well had many concerns and were hoping that we could urge public safety department to perhaps do a traffic study around the Lincoln School area as well. They've had some great ideas, perhaps making a left turn only off of Brown Street, or something needs to be done. Our children's safety is at stake here, and we can't keep putting this off. And then that meeting was back, I believe, in September at Radcliffe School. So I would urge the board to reach out to our public safety and our commissioners and re-examine all of our traffic patterns, perhaps around the school.
Any other old business? Any new business?
Yes, I'd like to really commend Mr. Kondarian, this wonderful, world-class group that he has. I mean, we're talking about the musicians. So I went to this holiday extravaganza, and it was absolutely tremendous. And Dr. Casal, I'm glad you're here tonight because it saves me a trip. As I get around the district and talk to many of the parents in the music program, learned that you had a lot to do with building that program over the years, so something you might want to look at and really be proud of. So I appreciate the work you did when you were here working with that group. But these are some of the things that make our school district proud, and I just want to publicly thank all the students and teachers, and particularly Mike and his staff for the job that they've done. And this is Eric, you're the head guy of this district, so thank you.
A final commercial announcement, the last performance will be Wednesday evening at St. Mary's Church, if anyone missed it. It really will put you in the holiday spirit. Very professional.
Any other new business? Seeing none, motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Before I accept the second, I just